Well, we all thought the boat race was going to be about the conditions, about the water. It was about the power. It was about the attitude of Oxford. They beat Cambridge by 6 lengths to win the 154th boat race. And James, impressive, but a quick word about Cambridge, because it was a brave, brave first 2 miles for them.
Yeah, they would have been up against it. They'd known the last 3 days since they lost their stroke man that they were going to have to put in something very special in the first few minutes. And Oxford, with the advantage of the first bend, asking some real questions. They're 3/4 of a length down, and if they'd slackened off then, they still had 15 minutes to row. They could have bottled out and said, oh, let's just pace ourselves. But they dug in, put in a sprint, and then put us under pressure all the way around the Surrey Bend. Good for them.
Was it just too much for them, do you think, when it came to that 2 mile marker? They had nothing left?
There was a point when Oxford were clipping a lot of water and their bow side looked really, really struggling around House of Bend. I thought if they'd pushed there, they may have been able to ask some more serious questions. But then Oxford settled, regrouped and just held on and then pushed when it got to their water.
Well, this victory means so much to Oxford. Celebrating there on dry land at last. Nick Brodie, the Cox, reaching up to hug his tall teammates. And Aaron Markovian, the guy we featured before the race, is with one of our reporters.
Aaron, sum it up.
I'm humbled. I'm humbled to be part of this, and I'm humbled for our competition.
A big moment.
Sorry?
A big moment for you.
It is. I couldn't be more proud, and I couldn't be more appreciative for this opportunity. To our competitors, to our team, to our coaches, our families, I'm truly honored to be here.
Were you concerned at one stage? I think Cambridge ahead just after Hammersmith Bridge.
To be perfectly honest, our plan was to sort of look ahead and we knew we could handle the rough water. So we went in and we tried to handle the rough water best as we could, and it seemed to be an effective plan.
And was it as hard as you expected in terms of conditions, or a little bit easier than some had predicted?
Well, when we raced the Americans, the conditions I feel were a bit worse than today. And that's kind of what we were prepared for. So today I was actually a little pleased that the conditions were favorable for our conditioning, but they were not as bad as they could have been.
Well done.
Thank you very much.
Part of the Oxford engine room there, Aaron Markovian. Every reason to be happy about it, but I was out on the water the day they raced the Americans, and it was far rougher than that. Do you think they're surprised by the conditions?
They nicely surprised. I mean, they 2 years ago, I think they're surprised by how bad it was, and they learned from that, and then it kind of geared everything. So that if it was that bad, they're ready for it, and if it was better, then it was a nice surprise. And that's what they had, their nice surprise with the water. Maybe they weren't so pleasantly surprised by the way Cambridge stuck up such a good fight.
I wonder how a boat race victory means compared to a world championship medal. We're going to find out now, because Mike Worley, the oldest man in boat race history, is with Gabriel.
Endless rhythm, and you know, we were patient. We knew that it might take a while for us to have the opportunity to really step on them, but when we saw that opportunity, it was all over pretty quick.
Patience was the key, was it, when Cambridge just went ahead after Hammersmith Bridge?
Yeah,
that was when you had not to panic.
Well, we knew we could put some pressure on them early, but we knew it wasn't going to be over early. And so, you know, we were able to put that pressure on them, but then we had to wait for our opportunity. When it came, we really stepped on their neck, and that was it.
How much tribute do you pay to your president, your cox, Nick Brodie?
Oh, he did a great job. He really called a good race, and he set up just a solid atmosphere for the whole year.
Now, the oldest man to row the boat race, now the oldest man to win the boat race, 36. What a bad effort, old man.
That's not that old. It's not that old. I'll be watching some older guys this summer at the Olympics doing a lot of great things as well.
And so. Tempted to keep on rowing? Tempted to come back and do it again?
No, I'm on a one-year course, and this is it for me. But I really love participating in it. It was a great, great experience for me the whole year.
Well done.
Thank you.
Ned should be very careful who he calls an old man. The purity of the boat race is you get a winner and you get the losers. And for the losers, nothing. Just tears, pain, 6 hard months of work. And let's be honest, James, they're going to feel like it was for nothing now, aren't they?
Yeah, right now they will. I mean, I think they can go back to the hotel, they get changed, they all have a dinner tonight, and I think those guys will look in the mirror and think, we did everything we could. And I think they could have been in a position after 3 or 4 minutes that they'd almost settled for second place and tried to hang on to Oxford and make the margin not so big, but they went for the win, and that ended up meaning the winning margin was that much bigger for Oxford, because they put so much into the first half of the race. Once Oxford broke clear, they had nothing left, but they did everything they could, and if you race and do everything you can, then you can't be too upset.
But it's such an incredibly cruel race, isn't it? I mean, it really is.
But that sport, it's not a nice place when you lose. It's a brilliant place when you win, and it's horrible when you lose. And that's why you train, to make sure you give yourself every possible chance of winning. And they will come back from this. The guys who are going to row, they're young, they're going to come back, and they'll be stronger next year. And the same way Oxford were this year, they were really angry about losing last year. And I think once they broke clear from Cambridge, they were demonstrating that stroke after stroke. They wanted to punish Cambridge for beating them last year. And in 12 months' time, we may see the exact opposite. Cambridge will hurt from this, and this will motivate through the cold months of winter.
Mike Worley really got that across when he said, we just kind of stepped on their throats. They're so powerful and so aggressive.
Nice for an old man, isn't it? He's not even a bit more gracious. He's won enough races, but he's a real, real cool head to have. When they're getting asked questions by Cambridge, middle of the boat, I imagine he was saying, stay strong, stay long, we're going to win this. And he was, I'm sure, a crucial part in their victory today.
Do you think he'd be feeling that? Do you think that's tougher than a world championship?
Again, it depends where you are. I mean, I'm sure halfway through the race, they'd race sort of 7 or 8 minutes and they would let dead level. It feels harder. But then after 12 or 13 minutes when you're 2 lengths ahead, it feels like you carry on all day.
How many of this crew do you think are going to go on to bigger and better things? Because they're so talented, aren't they, this Oxford crew?
They are talented, and it's difficult. It's difficult to say. There's so many things that make up whether you're a successful sport. It's not just the physical attributes. It's whether you've got the resilience to train for that long. And then also luck comes into it as well, whether you're successful. Look at the straight man of the Cambridge crew that got forced out through health problems. If that happens to people all the time. So they've got the talent, they've got the size, so who knows, you've got to stick at it.
OK, well, it's time for Oxford to celebrate. It's time for the presentation. Let's cross over to Peter Drury.
And that presentation, Craig, is to be conducted by the chairman of the Boat Race Company Limited, Giles Vardy.
Ladies and gentlemen, some people say the boat race is a relic of an elitist tradition. I say to them, think again. What we've seen today is one female and 17 male graduates from universities, world-class universities, take on an immense challenge. And I say, well done to both crews for a fine demonstration. You've seen pure sport today at its finest, and that's what we've been doing for 178 years at the boat race.
Well, this is the walk which Cambridge spared themselves with victory last year, but to which they returned now in the thrill of the moment 12 months ago. Their thoughtful, innovative Kiwi coach Duncan Holland said he rated Oxford the second best club in the world. Well, this year he must accept that Cambridge were second of two. And he will accept that with grace and style, because that is the boat race way, the Cambridge way. But it is Oxford's year this year. For Oxford, a win, and that is the reality of the boat race. It is only about now, and it is only winning. Perhaps crass to talk in terms of simple revenge in an event which has such a long and complex history, but Oxford were indeed sore about the aftermath of their defeat last year. So this moment is all the sweeter. How they wanted this, and how sweet a moment it is for President Cox, Nick Brody, small man, big ambition, who's been wounded more than most by the slings and arrows of boat race misfortune, but who now receives that trophy, which says that the 2008 boat race winners are Oxford.
Yes, the Oxford crew, they won't be feeling any of the pain there. Joyous celebrations, well deserved too, a great performance. So, how do they do it? Barney's going to tell us.
Well, we talked about it being a knockout race. I mean, unbelievable if you think about it. Brody, the president, he's got to sit there and lay out the strategy. So just like a boxing match, before the ring, you've got to get in there and you've got to punch him. You've got to nail him. And Brody's strategy, if we listen to what he's going to say right here. So he's talking there about the first 2 minutes. He's talking about the idea of really burying them in the first 2 minutes. Unfortunately, there's, as we know now, microphones on the boats, speakers on the boats. Rebecca Dowbiggin, the coxswain for Cambridge, mind games, listen to what she picked up.
I think I'm going to heard Brody say, like, they're going to golf really hard first 2 minutes. Can you just pass that down the boat? I don't want it on the bike.
Okay, now, interestingly enough here, the race hasn't even started. We've already got strategies playing out. As we watch this race unfold, we got to remember the first knockout moment we talked about, the black buoy. Okay, it's actually yellow. Remember when we see that shot. What you're going to see is the black buoy. And after the black buoy, you've got an opportunity here for Cambridge to break the, sorry, for Oxford to break the elastic. Okay, this is an elastic that's holding the two boats together. Oxford's in perfect position. Unfortunately, when elastic doesn't break, it snaps back. And unbelievably, Cambridge has managed to pull back. No knockout for Oxford. We're on to stage number two. So we're talking about Harrods Depository, of course. This is that great opportunity for Cambridge to take advantage of their huge bend, the Surrey Bend. They've got to land the knockout now. This is their only chance. If we go to the screen here, you're going to check out a very interesting opportunity for Cambridge to capitalize, not only on Oxford's position. Just let it run through here a little bit here. And I'm just going to show you, that's like an anchor. That's like someone's got the brakes on the boat. So not only is Cambridge ready to land a knockout, Oxford's just throwing the anchor out. So when we get going again, we're going to now find ourselves quickly realizing Cambridge has actually put themselves in that knockout position. We're going to see them with the lead, going through Hammer's Bridge. 85% of crews win when they go through the bridge. Okay, next moment, this is absolutely critical. Last year we talked about it. We had an incredible race last year. Well, Nick Brody hasn't forgotten that. He lost that race. He's in a position where he wants to show everyone that Cambridge is actually going to fall to the blow of Oxford. Here we go. Nick Brody sets them up.
Cambridge, just like last year, boy. Sapolsky, go! Seven seed, there! They lead the recovery, boys. Edwin Rowan.
And there you go, the knockout has been landed. It's an incredibly graphic moment, of course. There's no way for Cambridge to resolve themselves. They've fallen out. Oxford has knocked them out, and that's the end of the race.
Certainly was the end of the race. A brilliant job by Nick Brody. And I think he's going to get a bit of repayment for all the shouting he's been doing over the past 6 months. Why do we like this so much, James?
Well, as a rower, they've had 6 months of him sitting in the gym, not training. All he does is sit in the back of the boat. He does a bit of steering. That's about it. This is the payback for the cold winter mornings when they've been sweating it out, and they'll enjoy it.
These are the pictures that will be in the paper tomorrow. Nick Brody hopefully being hurtled into the murky, cold waters of the Thames. And not really the time to be thrown into the Thames this time of night. It's getting dark, isn't it?
I'm sure they'll look after him. But he's... I think he cost a great race there because he put real pressure on Cambridge. And although he'll be being dunked, he'll be a very happy man. He's got dropped from the boat race 2 days before, 1 year, and then he lost last year. So for him to win as present and Cox a really good race, he's done a great job.
I think he's actually hiding in Aaron Markovi's sideburns at the moment. Oh, no, they've got him. Here he goes. Nick Brody, 21 years of age, an Oxford local. It's his second time coxing the blue boat, his first victory. And this means so much to the single-minded little Cox. That doesn't mean too much to him. That doesn't look too pleasant.
It wasn't that deep either. They chucked him in a very shallow bit of water. But he won't mind at all. He's done a good job. It's quite difficult being Cox and present because he's not as physically imposing as somebody else. So he's had to be clever and had a really good strategy. He's led the club well to him.
It's funny, when some of the bigger boys go in the water and it comes up to their ankles, it comes up to Nick Brody's chest. Interesting that. He did say beforehand, about 2 weeks ago to me, that it's just another university boat race. Nonsense. Mind games. It means a lot to him, doesn't it?
It means a huge amount. And you don't go through three winters like he has, and this is facing the third winter of training and no win. He wanted to win more than anyone.
Okay, James, thank you very much. It's been a stunning day on the river. Oxford have won the 154th University Boat Race. A very memorable day for them, a memorable day for all of us. Goodbye.
2008 University Boat Race is away. Look at that, bow for bow, a real race in the rain. History will recall that 2008 was Oxford's year.